And welcome back to day four, podcast two in our series of gamification and mixed reality, brought to you by the Center for Teaching and Learning here at Humber College and Rexdale, Ontario. I hope you're doing well this week and you're ready for more exciting gamification update. What I promised you last week is that we would spend a little time talking about an interesting idea related to Ebbinghaus's work of how we get students to engage with material after we've presented so that they really start to own the material. But there's a fundamental kind of question we're going to kind of deal with today, and that is how do we get students to focus and pay attention? Now, attention is a really interesting area. A lot of my original work in cognitive neuroscience had to do with studying what attention is. And attention is signaled by waves that appear in the cortex, called the P300 wave, for example. This occurs 300 milliseconds after you hear a stimulus. So we do have waveforms and electrical activity in the brain related to focused attention. But what's really interesting is our ability to not focus our attention and how much that plays a part in everyday life. Stay with me here because you're going on a great little journey that just got me so excited when I looked at his work. Paul Howard Jones, not Howard Jones from the 1980s with the kind of mohawk, but Paul Howard Jones at the University of Bristol has been publishing since about 2011 using functional magnetic resonance imaging studies to look at what occurs in the brain of learners during game versus non-game conditions. So I'm going to get you a little bit oriented on slides like this. These are all fMRI images, so we're essentially seeing, as this test subject is thinking, what parts of the brain are lighting up. And these little regions here are called default mode networks. Now, what that means is that these are parts of the brain that shut off our focus in the external world and allow us to make things into procedures so we don't have to pay attention. You know, when you drove to work last time, you weren't thinking about everything on the road. You might have been thinking about what you're going to have for dinner, maybe it's cruising the radio dial. You weren't really focused. You weren't mindful of your driving. You were in a default mode, and that works for a lot of life. Imagine if it didn't work. We'd go nuts from the amount of information bombarding us. So our brain turns off certain things and puts us in default mode. But you get in default mode problems when you're a physician managing patients, where you start to space out a little bit and you're kind of working on habit rather than focusing on the patient in front of you, where we're seeing upwards, my colleagues at the University of Toronto Faculty of Medicine, we do a lot of good gamification work with, are assuring us that somewhere in the area of 70 to 80% of medical errors are from the doctor being in a default mode. They've seen so many cases that are like the one in front of them that they stop thinking about the details of that case and you make medication errors, etc. And our colleagues at Johns Hopkins, who do great work in cognitive science, have really illuminated us on the work of cognitive mode, kind of default mode processing during learning and teaching. Now, this is interesting. If you look at these figures, these are game-based. So this is a case where the learner was playing a learning game. Now, a simple learning game could be when you get this question right, you get $50. And if you get the next one right, you get $100. And if you get three questions right in a row, you get a bonus of 1,000. This is what's called a titratable game element. So they can move more risk and more game element in and out of it to titrate it, to measure it. The subjects that you see on the right are people that are engaging in learning the same material, but these subjects on the right are only using self-study. So they're going through their notes and reviewing the kinds of things that you might your students might do after a lecture. Now you see these here, these are the default mode regions that are lighting up, and this is a logarithmic scale. So if it's dark, it's real dark, and if it's bright, it's real bright. Look how bright and how extensive the default mode is in someone doing self-study. In other words, even though they're in the process of self-study, they're kind of spacing out. They're not really focusing. And we all know what happens when we study. We think about dinner. We think about things we want to do. Then we get back to the books. This kind of idea that it's very hard to escape and to be a very, very mindful state. And this is what he sees in his research. On the bottom panel, here we're comparing game-based versus self-quizzing in the same subject. Again, look at the size and the color of these default mode regions when they're doing quizzes. So when you're writing a quiz, you're still in default mode. Isn't that interesting? You'd think you'd be focused during quizzing, but quizzing is almost a pattern recognition process, especially in multiple choice. Look what's happening in game-based. Look how much smaller these area, and look at the difference in brightness. So we can see that according to the Paul Howard Jones work at Bristol, and he's published a lot in this area, that gamification seems to make us focus and pay attention and present with mindfulness and learning. That's pretty interesting, and he's not been able to replicate these effects using other techniques. Now, something else happens in his studies, and this has been replicated by other authors, and that is the stimulation of the ventral striatum. Now, the ventral striatum, as you can see, ventral means sort of top, and striatum means striped. It's a top striped area, and it's right down here in the basal ganglia. And this is a part of the region of the brain that we used to think was only involved in motor control. Michael J. Fox suffers from Parkinsonism as part of Parkinson's disease, which gives you shaking and these kinds of things. But we now know that the ventral striatum is the major reward learning center for the brain. And what it does is it contains a lot of neurons which contain a chemical called dopamine, which we're going to talk a lot about in our next podcast. And dopamine has a lot to do with reward prediction. So if I invite you over for dinner and I give you a great bottle of wine and I do that 5 or 6 times, you get the idea. When you're coming to my place, you're going to drink some seriously good wine. And then you show up and I have no wine for you, you're going to feel a little bit sad and say, what's with this? Do I not count anymore? It's this whole idea that that the ventral striatum helps us predict and adjust rewards. And what happens in game-based learning conditions is the ventral striatum lights up like a Christmas tree. It does not light up during self-study or quizzing. Now, this is the reward-based learning. So again, it's not the major reward center of the brain. It's the major learning reward. So a lot of what we do in life has to do with learning rewards. When we drink a beautiful Cabernet, we learn to associate that brand with a reward. When we think about beauty, we listen to a great death metal concert. Or if you like country music, there you go. If it's beautiful art, you head off to the gallery and you see your favorite show. All of these things are triggering off the ventral striatum. They're all triggering some kind of reaction, and your reward that you get when you go to the art gallery or go to a heavy metal concert is that your ventral striatum gets excited and it's giving you a feeling of reward when you hear your favorite music. These are very complex figures. I only put them up there to show that there's some science behind it. But again, this is again another picture using again this logarithmic scale from the fMRI showing that the ventral striatum is only activated during game-based learning condition in Howard Jones' work, which means that we're not only turning on the ability to space out in our students when they're gaming, but we're also turning on the reward learning mechanisms in the brain. Fascinating stuff right there. So, how much did you remember from last week on our Ebbinghaus forgetting curve? Geez, if you can answer this question, you're better than me, because I've forgotten already because I didn't review it. But again, what we want to try to talk about today and try to conclude with is the idea that memory is a very complex process and that gamification plays a big role, it appears from all the research that we've looked at, in not only focus, but reward, but also encoding, retrieval, and maintenance. This is pictures of the cortex, and you can see that encoding new memories, retrieving memories, or maintaining memories are all diffuse operations occurring throughout the brain. And so therefore, we have different types of working memory. We've given a couple examples here of phonological loops, which might be the hearing memory or listening to something and trying to remember it. Visual spatial sketch pad. This would be for knowing where you are in a room. These are scene-based memories. They're controlled by a neurotransmitter called neurotensin. We'll talk about that in later podcasts because that gets involved in virtual reality and scene. Very, very interesting work that's been done in that area. We also have central executive memory and episodic buffers. So I don't want to floor you with all kinds of research in the neuroscience of memory, but the basic idea is that video games seem to be able to tap into these memory circuits in a variety of ways. And neurophysiologic. We had a lot of early evidence that showed that fast-paced games, people that play them have better vision, better attention, and better cognition. It's not that video games are bad for you. It appears that video games are good for you. We know that certain video games can even encourage physical activity. They can also promote social interactions. There's some really fascinating work on violent video games and empathy. We have absolute evidence that when you play violent video games, your brain changes its morphologic structure so that when you see blood and guts being splashed on your screen, doesn't faze you at all. So you'd think that's a pretty bad thing. I'm not sure that's a good thing. However, a 10-year study looking at violent video gamers, these not violent video gamers, people that played violent video games, and looked at their empathy, and their empathy were either increased or stable throughout the 10-year period. There's a lot of video games that you go into that might be violent, but other people are playing the games with you and they'll help you out. We see altruistic player behaviors. So what's interesting is some of the ideas we have about video games being harmful or not useful for us may have to undergo some revision in thinking. And this is where we talk about it, that pro-social games, when we're actually helping someone in a game or in a learning game, these help others in real-life situations. And we also have all kinds of evidence, not only from Tetris players, but from players that play role-playing games and all kinds of interesting three-dimensional video games, that your cortex gets thicker. So areas like the entorhinal cortex and the hippocampus, the learning and memory circuit areas of the brain, actually increase in size. So gaming actually produces morphologic and functional changes in the physiology of the brain. This is the cognitive cycle, just enough to help us remember how little we know about it all. What I've tried to say today, that is that uncertainty gives us focus, and that's a take-home message we want to move forward on here. And that is that when you're not sure of a choice, and you have three equally compelling options in front of you, you're going to focus. You're going to say, geez, I want to do all three things. Do you want dinner? Do you want theater? Or a new car? Geez, they're both good. Maybe we'll take the car. The idea is that when you have three equally compelling options and you're forced to choose one of those options, this kicks us into an uncertainty phase, which then focuses our attention. And that's the basis of a lot of what we've talked about today. And that kicks off this complex circuit of memory that our earlier researchers could have never imagined. Here's a little taste of what we'll be talking about next week, the dopamine drip, dopamine release, and compulsion cycles in gaming. Until then, game on, have a great week. We'll see you next week with a little bit of neuropharmacology. Great stuff. See you then.